there. I'm Matt Holland and you're watching Irish Football Fan TV.
Hello and welcome back to Irish Football Fan TV. I've got Will back in studio again. For those of you who didn't meet Will last week, do you want to explain yourself, who you are?
Yeah, I'm just a presenter reporter in the UK, mainly covering football.
Okay. Yeah, England. This is what we're going to talk about for this episode.
Yeah.
England. Impressive result today.
Very impressive. Yes, it was against Panama, who would probably be in League Two with, you know, I suppose the squad they have. But you can only beat what you put in front of you. And I
similar
think England,
to the Russians. And,
yeah, and well, I think England have been the most impressive team so far because they've been clinical. And that is the one thing that has separated them from the likes of Germany, from the likes of Argentina. They have got off to a great start. They've got momentum, which is gathering. And as I said, they have been completely clinical in front of goal and being very impressive.
Yeah, I know last week we were sitting here, I think it was this day last week, we were sitting here and you were kind of saying about if Southgate can get them to click, you know, and be very impressive to see. And as I said, I'm a bit kind of sceptical because it is Panama, but they did look very good. And I thought they did look very good in their first game as well against Tunisia. Yeah. They just didn't score as many because I think Sterling missed a couple of saves and so did Lingard.
Well, you're always going to have first game nerves when you come into a World Cup, especially with that young squad, and they are England, so they do have pressure on them, and just getting over that barrier of getting the first win underneath their belts would have given them a huge amount of confidence, and we could see that confidence on the pitch against Panama. They just completely destroyed them. The first 10-15 minutes was a little bit shaky, but once they got the first goal, there was never going to be any other result.
Yeah, and John Stones on the score sheet was a bit of a bizarre one. He seems to pop up at the oddest of times.
Yeah, because I think he did make a mistake early on, which led to a little bit of a half chance for Panama, which they didn't take. But he's one of these players, he's got great technique, and we're waiting for him to become, I think, really the finished product, because obviously he was at Everton, he was chased by Chelsea, and then ended up going to Manchester City, who have a luxury of players in defence. So in a way he's a bit of a small fish in a big pond, that any mistakes that he does make at City will be punished because there are, you know, fully fledged internationals ready to take his place. He is one of the best defenders in England. Gareth Southgate has him in the team, and it is time for him to step up and kind of show exactly what he's made of. I just sometimes worry about him a little bit on the defensive side, that he does have that odd mistake in his locker, which when you come up against the teams like Spain, like Portugal, they will be exposed. But, you know, he seems to be getting better. And two goals as well at the other end.
Yeah, it's only going to help his confidence, and if he can kind of grow in stature as things go on. Because there was a period at Everton where he was really, really good, but then it was when things started to go bad, he started doing like Cruyff turns in his own box and stuff like that, and then, you know, he's turned around to the fans and been like telling them to calm down. So it's just stuff you just don't do. He's only a young guy at the time. But he seems to be learning from his mistakes and, you know, taking what Pep's saying on board and delivering.
Mm. Well, there's no better teacher, really, is there, for, you know, the way the Barcelona defence and the Bayern Munich defence has been schooled in the past few years. But I think as well for Gareth Southgate, in having that back three now settled with himself, Kyle Walker, and Harry Maguire, who I've been really impressed with as well. I really thought this would be a coming of age of Harry Maguire. He's done very well at Leicester City, but I was interested to see if he would make that next step up to, you know, a top level side. We've seen Kyle Walker and John Stones, obviously, in Man City. Good understanding there. But for Maguire, it's a big step to go from Leicester City to a World Cup. And then the wing-backs have done quite well as well. Now, the real test for them comes in the next game, because Belgium is a completely different level to Tunisia and Panama in attack and in the whole round team. I think England's biggest moment of the World Cup, I'm not saying it will be so far, but biggest moment perhaps of the entire World Cup will be the first 20 minutes against Belgium, to see how they compete against a side who are also now, I would say, one of the favourites for the title.
Yeah, definitely. And it'll probably be a case of, which, not maybe this season, but last season was a case of Kane versus Lukaku for the Golden Boot.
Yeah,
it could be a case for that now again. How impressive have you been with Harry Kane? We were sitting here last week and I said, I think we had predicted our Golden Boot.
It's going to be Ronaldo, I said, yeah.
Yeah, but we did kind of, you guys thought I was going to come out with Harry Kane, and I thought it was going to be a wild card, and I was going to sit back and go, maybe I should have picked him.
Yeah, like,
he's been awesome.
He has been, because again, you know, not to harp on about what I said earlier, but he's just been clinical. He has taken the chances presented in front of him. And that's what you want your striker to do. Yes, you want him to put in a good shift, a good work rate up front, chase, harass defenders, harry them, and put them under pressure to make mistakes for other players and to assist as well. But overall, if there's one thing your manager wants you to do, is put that ball in the back of the net, because it gives the rest of the team so much confidence that they have a focal point. And as well, he is the captain. He's leading by example, which is maybe sometimes what you haven't had from England. They've had leaders, but then there's always been these little clicks you feel within the group.
Yeah,
now they look like they're just... it just looks like it's one group now. One group following Harry Kane and Southgate. Everybody's on the same page. And that is a massive thing in a World Cup.
Yeah, and they have that big Spurs connection as well. Obviously, you've got Dele Alli and there's Trippier in there. Danny Rose.
Kyle Walker, obviously, as well. Walker, yeah, exactly. Anymore, but, you know, that Eric Dier's in that squad as well. So it's, you know, it's a nice little... It's good to have those little partnerships as well, because as well, when you play with a player every week, you know which way he's going to go when you get a ball most of the time. You know he's going to go to the left or to the right, or he's going to step over, or he'll use his head or that sort of stuff. So that, again, to me, is always, you know, another little extra percentage, which again can be, you know, a defining thing in these matches.
Have you been impressed with Lingard and Sterling?
Yeah, I think, listen, I don't think there's been too many players. I haven't been impressed with Sterling's work rate. Has been very good. The same with Lingard. And they've been getting in and just bombing forward and going for it, which is what I like as well. And there's been there's been no sort of other stories with them. There's been no petulance, no sort of moaning or anything like this for, you know, all the want that maybe some media outlets would have you want to try and blacken the name of you know... somebody like Raheem Sterling or one of the other players we've had before with Wayne Rooney getting into trouble. There's been none of that. Again, it just seems like one team that's together. Another player who's impressed, actually, I was watching today and I just thought, do you know what, he's almost come to another level as well. Jordan Henderson, I've been quite impressed with as a kind of a midfield sort of general. I thought he's done really well too.
Yeah, I think he's one of those players that always gets overlooked no matter what he does. I was saying to you off air there as well about Lingard. I feel as though he'd always be one of the players who never really gets the recognition unless you're watching him week in, week out, and specifically focus on him. And it's more so the fans of that club he plays for would recognise it more. A lot of Liverpool fans would be raging on how can you not see what I see, what he does, and same with Lingard type of thing, you know.
Well, this is it. And then, you know, we had as well the one change. Dele Alli was out of the team. Ruben Loftus-Cheek came in as well.
You call that.
Yeah. He's stepping up to the plate. And that's, you know, I've seen Ruben now with my work at Chelsea for a good few years. And I've seen the capability. I've spoken to players and managers, you know, who've worked with him and said, this kid has got everything in the locker. He just needs to step up and realise he's this good and take his chance. And that's what we saw against Tunisia in the opening game. He came in. It was like, again, no fear, right, I'm just going for it. And he went for it, and he was the difference in them getting that win. Again, he stepped up.
He drove forward.
Yeah, he drove forward. Too. Again, listen, it's only Panama. We can't get too carried away. But again, he was impressive, and this is what they need to do. There's belief there now. But again, the first 20 minutes against Belgium, to go out there, continue that belief and not be afraid, and that could be a defining moment, I think, in their World Cup.
Well, I think for both sides, it's their first real test. England, they're not a bad side. Like, we can't sit here and go, you know, they're a bad side, because every single player there we watch week in, week out, and all play for good clubs.
Yeah.
The only thing I'd say about Belgium is they weren't obviously as clinical against Panama.
No, they weren't. But listen, it's on the day as well. You know, that's to me is not that, you know, they beat them convincingly. They beat Tunisia more convincingly than England did. So it swings and roundabouts in that sort of way. Both teams will be going into this game full of confidence. Both will have an eye on who they're going to play next. It'll be interesting to see, you know, who wants who. And I suppose both will be through as well. So there will be maybe a slightly err on the side of caution, because they don't want yellow cards, they don't want suspensions or red cards, and they don't want injuries as well. Players want to, you know, make sure that they are fit, because they don't want to miss out on essentially the biggest games in their career, because a World Cup may never come around for them again, for whatever reason, through lack of qualifications, through suspension, through injury, whatever. So there will be that on their mind. But yeah, I'm expecting a really good game. Hopefully an attacking game. And I think we've seen both teams, Belgium and England, play with freedom, which is, to me, exactly what you want in a World Cup. Because I think sometimes at this World Cup, we haven't seen teams play with freedom. There's been a lot of negativity at times and fear of the opposition. Now we're going into the closing games. Hopefully teams will open up a bit more and have a few more goals.
Yeah, and you wanted to touch a little bit about Soke. How much of a rating would you give him out of 10 for the first two games so far anyway.
Yeah, listen, I think so far he's done 8.5 out of 10. I think he's been, you know, again, we can't go too far because of the quality of the opposition. You know, he goes and stuffs Belgium 4-0, then it's 10 out of 10. Can't ask for him to do any more. That's England's highest World Cup score of their history. So, you know, that's something that goes down in the record books. His name will be against. As I said, I think the atmosphere he's created with the sort of guy that he is, the lack of ego with Gareth, and that he just will get on with the players, I think that's all being played out on the pitch.
Yeah, you can see he seems like he's almost friends with a lot of the players. He's going to high-five them and stuff like that. It just looks very relaxed. In recent years, you would see managers not even speaking to those players.
Mm. Yeah, I don't think it's a case of being friends. I think it's a case of having respect and being close to the players and knowing that you're backing them. But also, he's their manager at the end of the day. He's the one who has to make the decisions about dropping X, Y, and Z. For instance, the next game, Dele Alli's fit. Does he bring him back in, or does he leave Ruben Loftus-Cheek 6-1? How do you change that sort of a team? That's a big decision for him now. So we'll see how that goes. But that's what I'm saying. I just think his man management has been really, really, really good so far, and that's been key with England.
So, England fans, let us know your thoughts in the comments. We thought we'd touch over that game and give a little bit of a review. So let us know what you think about that. Thanks for watching.